Hi, everybody, and welcome to episode 41 of the I Rock Knits podcast. My name is Corey Eichelberger, and today we're going to do a sock episode. So welcome to everyone. I know lots of people are spending their time at home right now, and so I am going to try to put up some episodes for all of you to have a little bit of entertainment or podcast watching while you're knitting for homes for a while. The entire world has been affected by COVID-19 or the coronavirus, and people are really making hard decisions right now about staying home and not being near friends or family, as well as businesses. So I'm going to try to do my part and help out where I can, and this is one of the things that I can do. So let's get started. I'm going to start today with just a tad bit of information. When I introduce myself at the beginning of every podcast, I say that my name is Corey Eichelberger, and I married the name Eichelberger and didn't really want it when I was young. I was a teacher, and having a 12-letter last name seemed like it was going to be a little bit onerous. Now, to be fair, I was a Schmidt before, S-C-H-M-I-T-T. My students would often call me Miss S-H-I-T. So Eichelberger could have been a step up from that, correct? But I will say for the last 8 years, something like that, that I've known and been married to my husband, I have had to spell that last name. And when you spell Eichelberger, you say E-I-E-I-O. Every single time I spell it, I want to say E-I-E-I-O. And sometimes I do, and then people get really confused and they don't laugh along with me. And other times I don't. But my last name is spelled E-I-C-H-E-L-B-E-R-G-E-R. So I just thought I would share that little piece of information with all of you because I find it funny. And I want to make everyone have a little bit of levity right now. Additionally, I was born on the 19th of the month. And if anyone is of a certain age and is born on the 19th of the month, then you say my birthday is April 1961. And people think you're saying 1961. So then they'll often re-ask you for the date of your birth, and you have to say it's 1961. And you can get a little who's on first thing going with all that. So I have to spell my last name, and then I have to say 4-19-61. 19-1961. Oh, the little things that affect us in our daily life that we can just laugh at, right? I just thought I would share those things today. I'd written myself a little note to talk about it because it happened to me the other day, and I went round and round with the woman on the phone a couple times just getting it all straight. And I thought, oh, wouldn't it be easy if my name were, you know, Jones or Brown or something? Maybe that would make... And if I hadn't been born on the 19th day in the 19th century, 20th century, 19. Okay, we'll just move on, right? We are having an Up North Cal that is running in my Ravelry group right now. However, if you want to participate on Instagram, you may feel free to do so over there. I have a couple of prizes up on the prize thread in that group. And the hashtag that we're using right now is Up North Cal. So all one word, UPNORTHKAL. And that includes anything that is a part of the Up North series that I designed and published in the last month. So let's take a look at one of the things that you can knit is the Up North sock. This is a second version of that sock. I didn't use multicolored thread at the top. I just used two strands of a worsted weight and made a coordinating. This would be really cute with a toe and a heel also in the gold. But I do a heel, so I don't always get that option to put in a afterthought heel or a cut-in heel. And then here is the hat that is done up in a similar vein, different than the first one I did. And I used the red, green, and blue from the other skeins of yarn that I had. Did not include the gold or the gray, and had a little bit of gray, you can see, a little bit of gold there, I mean, left over. So those two items are available. The mitten pattern has been tech edited, laid out, and the testers have sent me their notes, which needed some tweaking to the pattern, and that was sent to my tech editor. So I'm thinking this week the mitten pattern should go live to match, to coordinate with all this. And then I'm also writing up a cowl pattern, which will just be a number of stitches to cast on in order for the actual stitch count to work with this. And then it will have the trim at the top and the bottom with some little tassels around the top. I will provide that to anyone who has purchased the hat, mitten, or sock pattern, I think, as a free download on Ravelry, that you can just do the cowl. I will kind of gift it or add it as a PDF and do an update into those patterns so that you will have it. Because all you really need is a good cast on number, and then you already know how to do the one by one ribbing and the Andalusian stitch. That's what this is called. Andalusian stitch, which is just texture, super simple. So if you've got some worsted weight yarn at home and you're home more than you normally would be and you want to cast on a worsted weight project, I can do the hat pretty easily in a day from morning till night if I'm just sitting in the chair doing a Netflix marathon. Otherwise, two evenings could get you a hat, depending on how long you want that brim to be. And you can do the sock very quickly. It's a really good starter sock if you've never made a sock before. And since today is the sock episode, I think this is a good beginner sock. It's a checklist pattern if you've never knit one of my patterns before. All my patterns have a checklist for every row that you need to execute when you're doing the pattern. And you just check it off. That way you know where you're at, you know the next step. Not a whole lot of words with paragraphs or a lot of charts to be read, especially in a pattern like this. It's just every step is written out for you and you can check it off. Or if you are a master knitter and you don't need that kind of hand holding throughout a pattern, just feel free to read right through and you can just take off and not have to use those checklists. But I do get really good feedback from kind of advanced beginner to intermediate knitters about liking to have that checklist pattern, knowing where they're at when they return later to work on it because they know right where they left off. So I have continued to write almost all of my patterns in that checklist format since I started that, oh gosh, several years ago. Oh, you guys, it started snowing. Oh, you know, we're really ready for spring here, but we do not have spring. I still have a pretty good size, you know, spot of snow in my front yard. And this, I can just see it out the window here starting to snow. So also, I put the PDF version of how I teach my beginning knitting classes on my website as well as on Etsy. So if you go out to my Etsy shop, all my patterns are available there as well as on Love Crafts. Everything's been updated as of last Friday. Or Thursday even. The gal who had asked previously, well, you won't know who she is, Kimberly. Kimberly, thank you. She is getting all my stuff put on Love Crafts as well as Pinterest. If you are a Pinterest person and you like to keep track of knitting patterns, you can go out and kind of pin those patterns as something that you might want to knit on later. She has got them all up. So you can go to Etsy or my website to get the PDF version of how I teach beginning knitting classes. And all my classes have been canceled. So I am not going to Michigan next week from now to teach my sweater and shawl workshop. And I talked to Susan from A Piece of You Yarn Shop. Hi, Susan, and all the ladies at A Piece of You. I'm really bummed to not be coming. I didn't have a lot of teaching where I was traveling this winter, and this is just going to be one that was going to be fun, but I would have had to go through the Detroit airport into Saginaw and then into a shop of women who would be in a small space. She had sold out both, you know, kind of both sessions with 30 people, and they're just not recommending that kind of gathering, especially since I could have then picked something up and, you know, infected people without knowing it going through an airport. So especially a major international airport. So we made that that really tough decision. And Susan had brought in extra yarn and was rearranging the yarn shop in order to seat all those people. And so I just, you know, you really feel bad for local yarn stores right now, because although we all don't always get into them very regularly, kind of all in together we do, right? We provide them with their means to a living. And so if you have, you know, a few extra dollars, go out and spend that. You know, give everybody permission to go buy some yarn. Either call your local yarn store locally and send, you know, and say, put it hold for me, and or I'll, you know, run it out to my car, or go online and purchase that, because boy, it's going to be a tough time here. I recently saw that our big event at the end of April has been canceled, Yarn Over in Minnesota. And I don't want to be a downer on this podcast, right? One of the things that I wanted to talk about today is that several weeks ago, I heard someone say, don't complain with your mouth full. And I wrote it down. Because I can be a bit of a complainer. I like to kind of wallow a little in, oh, I had so much to do today. That kind of thing. I'm super verbal. I talk all the time. My husband's a quieter guy. And so when he comes home, he's often not going to talk about a bad day. I am going to talk about a bad day, right? I can be that person. And so right now in my life, I am still very fortunate. I can stay home and not teach, won't be teaching at the library in April, and not get that paycheck, and we will be okay. And we have food in the freezer and in the pantry, and I'm going to make very interesting meals if groceries get, you know, sparse. And we have the ability to order, you know, things online that if we really need them. And so I'm going to try really hard to not complain with my mouth full. So just something to think about, right? If you are in a situation where you have a really hard time with all of this, and you are struggling financially or physically or mentally, socially with, if you've got small children who are becoming worried, I know that that's something that would have been an issue in my house. We had some things happen to us when Kylie was little, and that really affected her. You know, we were kind of near a tornado at one point, and near, back in the day when in Virginia, we were near the shooter that happened, and, kids were on school lockdown. Those things can really affect us. So I just want to be supportive and uplifting of all of you in that, and not complaining about, you know, something that I have to do, which is maybe stay home and knit for a little while. So, anyway, let's not be sad or down about that. But Judy B, we found an Appleton knitting group for you at the Casting On Yarn Shop, so I'm really excited about that. We had someone get in touch, and that was a note that I had sitting here on the table, so I don't think I had said that before. I have a really short audiobook section this week. I read one book and I really enjoyed it, so I wanted to get it in quickly. I read The Dutch House by Ann Patchett, narrated by Tom Hanks, which is really ironic since we all probably know that Tom Hanks and his wife have been tested positive for coronavirus in Australia and are sheltering in place and staying quarantined. He has such a phenomenal and recognizable voice, and he just does a wonderful job. This is a story about a house, and she is an excellent author. Many of you have read other books by her. Some of you have probably already read this one. It is a richly moving story that explores the indelible bond between two siblings, the house of their childhood, and a past that will not let them go. The Dutch House is a story of a paradise lost, a tour de force that digs deeply into questions of inheritance, love, and forgiveness, of how we want to see ourselves and of who we really are. I really enjoyed the book. It's a brother and sister. I happen to have two brothers, but It's a situation of sadness that kind of sets up the whole premise of the book going forward and then follows them throughout their lives. I can highly recommend this with the narrator of Tom Hanks, and it is 9 hours and 53 minutes long. I read it in just a couple, or listened to it in just a couple of days. It was really good. Day, a yarn that was on a label, and underneath the label it had the words "No mulesing," mulesing free, something like that. And I was like, I don't know what that is. So I came home and I Googled it, and it's really an interesting practice, something that I was not aware of. So I'm going to share that with you. Mulesing is the removal of strips of wool-bearing skin from around the breech or the buttocks of a sheep to prevent the parasitic infection or fly strike. The wool around the buttocks can retain feces and urine, which attracts flies. The scar tissue that grows over the wound does not grow wool, so is less likely to attract the flies that cause fly strike. Mulesing is a common practice in Australia for this purpose, particularly on highly wrinkled merino sheep. And mulesing is considered by some to be a skilled surgical task, and but it is a very controversial practice. I had no idea. I didn't know that that was a thing. And I didn't even know that you could get yarn that would come from sheep that had not had that done to them. And so if you're interested in that kind of thing, there's a lot of information out there. I found a whole article on Wikipedia that had some links and places that I could go to kind of to look at it, but it is considered a cruelty situation if they are taking that skin off the hind end and, you know, then letting it scar over. So really interesting, kind of sad I didn't mean to go there, but it is something that I think, you know, we need to be aware of if we have practices in the industry that might affect us in our buying practices and what we support and who we support. So I'm, you know, just sharing that today. This is how I store my socks. I'm gonna hold it up for all of you. That was an ornament box, and I found it. It had a lid that flipped over onto the top, and it had little dividers, but mostly what it had was long, narrow spaces that would fit an actual pair of socks folded in thirds. And so I've been storing my socks like this for a number of years. I know I posted it on Instagram, and a bunch of people went out at, you know, Christmas time or after on Amazon and picked up an ornament box also to kind of follow this practice. I don't keep them in my drawer. I have other socks that I wear. So I have some different kinds of socks for walking at the dog park in the winter. And I have some little cotton socks for going to the gym, or if I know that I'm gonna be sweating or walking or out in the yard and getting, you know, muddy feet or whatever. So I have a drawer of those that are kept separate. And then I keep all my hand knit socks in this bin. And I didn't count them, but 4 rows of 12. So I probably have, and I have a bunch already on sock blockers stacked here in front of me. So, you know, I probably have 50 or 60 pairs of socks. And in the day when I was really sock knitting often and a lot, I knit all these socks, not because I needed more socks, because I was doing the thing that I do now with sweaters and shawls, is finding new techniques or skills in order to improve my practice. So almost all of my socks are not vanilla socks. Some are, but most of them are socks with a feature. So that's what we're gonna be going over today, is just a bunch of different socks. I don't have a lot of incredible knowledge to share with you about how to make your socks better or worse or that kind of thing. I just have a lot of very, very fun, interesting patterns to show you. If you're not a sock knitter, I think you could be inspired by the yarn. So you can, you know, hang in there with me because I'm going to go through these fairly quickly. I put a bunch on sock blockers and then I'll take a break and put a bunch more on so you can see them to their best effect. Okay, so the first ones on the top of my stack today are socks that my husband wears. And these are Business Casual Socks by Tanis Lavallee. I don't know if it helps you guys for me to hold it up, but I put notes at the top of each sheet yesterday, sat down, and this is what the sock looks like. Isn't that fun? So this was a pooling kind of yarn. I wanted to make him purple socks because we're Vikings fans, but he wouldn't want to wear a super bright pair of purple socks, you know, on the regular. And so having the black in there with this definitely helped. And you get this just really interesting diamond stitch effect. I mostly do a heel flap and gusset on all my socks. I'm a top-down sock knitter, and I use double-pointed needles exclusively. I have knit socks on two circs. I have knit socks on a magic loop, and I learned on double-pointed needles, and I just love my double points. And I learned cuff down. I have knit socks toe up. I don't like to knit them that way. I don't know if it's because I practice cuff down so many times that toe up just seemed awkward. Here's another pair of his socks that I knit in this stitch pattern. So I would say that although this could, you know, go either way for a man or a woman's sock, if I knit it in a dark colorway for him, he is really happy to wear them to work. He wears them with his dress pants. He does dress up for work every day. He doesn't have to wear a suit or tie, but he does have to wear a dress shirt and, you know, what we would say are nice slacks. Does anyone else use those terms from back? That's what my mom would say. A nice pair of slacks, Corey. I just think that's a funny word, slacks, right? But so those are the Business Casual Socks by Tanis Lavallee. I would say that I knit most of my socks on 64 or 68 stitches. Ross is on a 72 sock. This is the Cafe Macchiato sock. This sock is for sale for $2. This sock pattern, it's by Marion Molden. And I use String Theory Colorworks. See the little stitch pattern that happens right along the edge? You'll see here, here is the stitch pattern. It runs here and here, two places along the right side, but not along the left. I have to remember, Fish Lips Kiss, I think. Yep, that's what that one was. So I cut in the heel after the fact and then picked up and went in and did that. That's a great pattern written by a Minnesota woman. It's a pattern from years ago that was, you know, that people would have had memorized and known, but she wrote it down and put it in a pattern. And the pattern is a very good, well-written beginner sock pattern. It just talks about making a template of your foot by drawing around it on cardboard. And that pattern is $1, Fish Lips Kiss. You do not have to print all 16, 17, 18 pages of that pattern that tell you how to knit the sock. There is a couple of pages right in the middle that are just the heel. If you already know how to knit a sock and you just want that heel pattern, you can, I don't remember, but it's, you know, it's like pages 7 and 8 or something or whatever they are, that you can just print to get that heel. So this is String Theory Colorworks yarn, self-striping, which I think is just super interesting. You don't see stripes like this a lot. And then just this stitch pattern right there. So, and then the next pair are the Mystic Spiral Socks by Josh Ricks, another Minnesota designer and friend. These were really popular when they came out in 2014 and 15. I think everyone was knitting Mystic Spirals. It is a sock that has the patterning going different directions. I think it's a little bit easier to see on my sock blocker than on the ones that are on his feet, because you can kind of see it flat here. And I used neon rainbow yarn from HD Yarns, and I don't think they're dyeing yarn anymore. I'm pretty sure they're not dyeing yarn. They were on Etsy, I think, for a while. But this is like a neon rainbow, and it's a heel flap and gusset. Josh had a short row heel in the pattern. I think he had Megan Williams OMG heel in the pattern. And when she first, when Megan first put that pattern out, it did not fit me very well. And then she did an extended version. So she did a spacious OMG heel, which then fit me better. But at the time, her OMG heel was too shallow for me, for my foot. And so I couldn't use it. So I put a heel flap and gusset in Josh's sock pattern. These are toe-up socks, which, you know, I said is not my forte. I don't have those rows figured out exactly right for how long I need to make the sock. You have to, when you knit a cuff down sock, the thing that I like about it is that you can put it on. And you can put it on, you can put it on, you can put it on when it's on the needles. And then when you get down to here, you can try it on and stretch it and figure out how where to start your toe. When you're doing a toe-up cuff, sock, it is a little harder to figure out where you need to start your heel to make this the fit right. And in the first pair that you make, if you get it right, then you can count the rows from your toe up and you'll always know where to start your heel. So you can make that decision. You can say, oh, I wish it would be a little bit longer, and you can add a few rows. It's just a matter of counting rows. I never wrote those numbers down. I never figured it out and kept track of it. And so for me, I always have to go back to a previous pair to figure out, you know, what I'm doing as far as making toe-up socks fit for me. Oh, this is just a lovely pair. One of my favorites of all time. These are the Zigzagular Socks by Susie White. And this is a free pattern on Ravelry. That's one of the reasons last night I was kind of excited about doing the sock episode, is because I have a lot of free sock patterns to show you guys. So, well, we're all loving on the socks. We can actually get some of these patterns for free. This sock yarn is Rainbow and Clouds by Abby Grasso, and I will talk about it. But here, I'll show you real close that this is the only pattern, stitch pattern, that you have going on. The rest of the sock is plain. You have a heel flap and gusset, and that's how the pattern was written. So it is gonna interrupt your stripes. If you have striping going down and around to here, if you have this in here, your stripes sequence is gonna be interrupted, right? And we all probably know that, but if you put if you cut a heel in, your striping sequence can remain pretty whole. So because I started with gray right here, I may have cut this to restart with gray. I don't remember if I did or not, so that it kind of maintained that progression all the way down. I might have made, I'm thinking I probably did. Okay, so Zigzagular Socks, free pattern by Susie White of the Prairie Girls, of the Prairie Girls Knit and Spin audio podcast, which is a lovely, funny, hilarious, love those ladies a lot. But the Rainbow and Clouds yarn is something that I'm not sure everyone's super aware of. Abby Grasso is the indie dyer behind this yarn. And she has figured out a way to dye yarn so that when you knit it, you will have pictures in your knitting. If you knit to the right circumference and the right stitch gauge, you will get a pattern on your knitting. So check these out. She has dyed that to happen. So there are white and pink and blue and gold and little black specks in your yarn, and you knit a plain sock and that happens. Can you imagine? So she has a whole bunch. There are rainbow sheep and Christmas trees and a snowman ornament and polar bears. These are Artistic Yarns by Abby. Sheep. Pac-Man. You can also do that like that. There are little toadstools. I mean, that is genius, right? Artistic Yarns by Abby, A-B-I. and you can pre-order the kits and the colorways from her, and then you'll get them. She dyes to order. She also has self-striping yarn and other yarns in her shop. I looked yesterday, I have a couple of skeins of the yarn to knit the pattern pictures, and I haven't done it yet. I need to, because they're wonderful. I thought they were great in the day, but this is how the yarn would look, and this is how it would knit up. I mean, that's some amazing stuff. So if that's something that really, you know, excites you and you're like, wow, go take a look at her yarns. To see all the other, I printed a few pages in color for you guys, but I didn't print all of the pages. Next pattern, this is My Cup of Tea Socks by Robin Lynn. I really like this pattern. It's on the top of the sock only. It's right there, and you get this little V stitch that happens. And it just bumps up the self-striping yarn a little bit. Here is the original. It's in a solid, so you can maybe see it there. Not focusing very well. These socks came out in 2012, and it is a heel flap in the round, top down, cuff down, a written pattern, and it is free. My Cup of Tea. Really a cute. It is written for 64 stitch cast on, but you can add stitches since the pattern's only on the top. Okay? And then another pair. These are the Vanilla Bean Stripe Socks by Emily O'Grady, who used to have the Whatcha Swatchin' podcast. Oh, I wonder if those are still out there. I really enjoyed that podcast. It was a video podcast back in the day. These are from 2012, and my yarn bled. So it used to be red and white, just so you know. So my yarn bled quite a bit. But I still really liked the stitch pattern. This is, again, a free pattern. It's just a slip stitch to move the stitch up into the next row. And then I had the green heel toes and cuffs. So they should be bright white and red. I think that's the biggest issue that you can find with self-striping sock yarns is if there is white incorporated in it and any red at all. Those are the hardest yarns to get all the color out of, is red. Red is a hard one. But I still really liked the pattern, and it didn't hurt the socks. There was nothing wrong except that they turned pink instead of red and white. And I'm, you know, still wearing them. No problem there. That's the Jay Walker sock. I have another pair of those in here. Aren't these fun? More stripes repeated more quickly. And I did put a heel flap and gusset on those, but those would be but from Grump Arena too. These are probably the fanciest socks I've ever knit. These are called cross-wired. Aren't those amazing? Two colors of yarn, striping throughout, slipping the pink as you go up the top. These are by Wendy Gall, and she is Knitters Brewing Company. So she's a yarn company out of California. She had a podcast for a number of years. She does quite a few knit-alongs, if knit-alongs are a thing that you enjoy, and she does design some work too. These were slip stitches, toe up. There's a video tutorial on how to make them. And I will show you her pattern here. It was a $5 pattern download. They do have a textured stitch along the back as well. Yeah, look at that. So you got stuff going on. the whole time. All color workers worked doing slip stitches, so you are never working with more than one color at a time. And they've used their favorite no flap gusset heel and topped this pair with a cuff to match those cables. So that's a no flap gusset heel. Just super interesting. I learned so much knitting these socks. This pattern also came out in 2012, and it was using a light fingering. I used two of her, her yarns in the two colors. I ordered the kit from her, I think, to knit this, and it was a knit along on her podcast, cross wired. I'll try to get all of the pattern names put up on the screen for all of you, and I will also put a list on the Ravelry page in the show notes and down below the video of each of the names of the socks and the designers, so you could just go print it out and look at them at your leisure. Okay, this is the Harvest Dew by Yvette Noel, and I used Drachenville Merino yarn, and it was a $4 pattern. It is kind of a pooling or self-striping, but not straight self. So my stitch pattern got a little lost, right? It's a slip stitch pattern, but I think they turned out really fun. Here are the pictures of them. They go down to a point on the top of the foot. And a really fun, interesting slip stitch pattern. It's a cuff down using a charted stitch pattern, and the pattern is written for Magic Loop. And I did not use Magic Loop on these that I remember, but I could have. This next pair are the most challenging socks I ever knit, I think. These are the Skews by Lana Holden, and it is a free pattern once again. It came from Knitty, winter of 2009. So that is the Skew pattern. I think in this colorway, this is the Fish Knits yarn in the rainbow colorway. It is just, these socks are stunning. I'm going to hold up the sock. When you knit the Skew sock, everything's knit on the diagonal, and then when you get to the heel, you do a flippy-do, and you turn and go across before you head back down to the toe, where you get that anatomically correct right and left toe. These socks have never been worn. Because they were such a challenge to knit, and I love the brightness of the color, that they just make me happy in my sock drawer. It's kind of a shame. They fit. They're a little big. I went a little too long before doing the toe. Not terribly. If I washed them, they probably would fit a little better. But they're called Skew because everything is on, the diagonal the whole way. It's a very interesting heel construction. You come out here and then you Kitchener this bit. So if you like a good challenge, you might want to try. Oh, look at that colorway though. Isn't that just stunning? No wonder I don't wear them. Oh, they feel brand new. Never been washed. So SKEW, that's what they're called. Oh, the mailman is bringing packages. I'm going to let him. Okay. This is probably one of my favorite pairs I've ever knit. These are called the Little Pumpkin Socks. They are a free Ravelry download. Look at those little pumpkins. Aren't they cute? It's got a little garter stitch trim on the heel and a stitch pattern. Oh, I just think they're so cute. I used Fiesta Yarns Baby Boom, and these came out in 2007, and they're by Sabine Rupert, and she has written out the chart in the instructions here on the front page of the pattern. I just think they're super cute. You have two little ribbed stitches, and then a little bit of seed, and then ribbed, and then seed, and then ribbed in each of the pumpkins all the way up. Really cute. Very fun. another stack here. Aren't these amazing? These are the Groovy Socks by Caroline Hegwer, and I knit mine using Lollipop Yarns. It's the other colorway I have them in. I love these, a free pattern. I originally wrote the Groovy Socks many years ago, but the pattern disappeared from the internet. After so many requests, I decided to rewrite it. I rewrote it with many improvements. The chevron stitch pattern and the ribbed edge now flow smoothly into each other, and the heel is an afterthought heel, keeping you in your chevron stitch groove until the end of the foot. The pattern now comes in multiple sizes from child to adult. And when you go out there, it will say Internet Archive, Wayback Machine, and then you have to click on that. It will take you to a blog post for these socks to get them for free. There's also a link at the bottom on the pattern page, but they did disappear for a while and people couldn't get their hands on them. And then she redid the Groovy Sock pattern. It's just an interesting stitch. Very fun to do. So I had two pairs of those out there. Okay, these are called the Katniss Socks. From Suzanne Collins's books, The Hunger Games. And I had read those back in the day with my daughter. This was knit in Hazelnitz yarn, which is still fairly popular and out there. Beautiful yarn, nice yarn company. And the colorway is Chuckanut Drive. And all my patterns, everything I'm talking about today is linked on my project page. So if I'm not giving you enough information, because I'm just trying to do this quickly, so that you have a lot of inspiration for knitting socks, you can go out and look and see exactly how I knitted, what heel I used, or there will be pictures and the yarn will be listed. But this one has the cable up the back and up the front of the top, and it is a kind of a interesting cable. She took a picture out in a field with a little tractor, and I really like that picture there. So yeah, another free pattern, the interesting cable stitch, and then ribbed. It's ribbed here. I like a ribbed sock. I think they fit so much better. You know, when you're knitting socks, you really want negative ease, meaning you want the sock to turn out smaller than the circumference of your foot so that it has to stretch when you put it on. I mean, that's what the way all socks work. So I really like when that, I don't love a vanilla sock as much when it doesn't give me that negative kind of pulling in from a rib. I like a rib much better. A 3x1 or a 4x1 rib is really much more my jam than a plain vanilla sock for fit purposes for me. These are the Seaweed Socks by Lauren McMorty, and Lauren had the Lem Knit Crochet Designs podcast, and she designed these beautiful socks. There is the stitch pattern. Goes down the outside of the foot. This sock color is much brighter in person. It is a teal colorway, and I knit these for Teal Timber, which was for ovarian cancer awareness. My friend Vicki, who had a podcast at the time, had a knit along, and I knit teal socks. And these are $5.50. And she did them as a fundraiser. It was a fundraiser for a friend that had an accident. There is a tutorial for the afterthought heel socks and a PDF that's included in the pattern. And lovely, really pretty. Okay. I used Unwind Yarn Company yarn on this pair. I had that written down. The teal was from Unwind Yarn Company. All right, these are interesting. Look at these. This is the Socks on a Plane pattern by Laura Lindemann of the Knit Girls. It's a free Ravelry pattern. And this yarn is corn, made out of corn. It's a corny goodness. The pattern was free, and they are taking a break from dyeing right now, and I don't know what the situation is, but they were a Minnesota farm couple who developed a yarn line using corn. And I would say that these socks feel closest to cotton, but I'm assuming that they would be considered an acrylic or plant-based fiber. they're not wool. But there's that stitch pattern. It's just a cable that goes up the outside of the foot all the way. It's got that interesting no flap heel on it, and free. An interesting yarn that I wanted to knit those up with. And they've worn really well. I mean, really well. They do feel a little more like cotton than wool, but they're, you know, quite stretchy. I mean, they're firmer than a sock, but they do have a little give to them than a wool sock, I mean. Okay, Mad Color Weave by Tina Lauren of Knit Tenacity. And this is a fish knits colorway. So I really like the maroon and gold because we do a lot of University of Minnesota stuff here. And so I liked the maroon and gold in this colorway. And then it's got all these interesting stitches on the front and the back. And then this goes down and it goes all the way down and drops into the heel, which I think is just super fun on that heel flap edge. And then you do the turn and head toward the toe. So this is a free Ravelry download. I used the fish knits yarn, and it is a top down, cuff down, twisted stitches. And then we have the Aim True socks. This is the Hunger Games inspired sock as well at the time. And it's got this V construction cable look at the top, and then again on the top of the foot. Kind of a ribbed stitch here, and then the V around the top and on the top of the foot. Heel flap and gusset, top down. It is a discontinued pattern, but you can get it on Etsy. So for most of these patterns that I'm saying you can get on Ravelry, there are other places to get them. You can find them on people's blogs. You can find, especially the free ones, you can find them on Knitty. You can find them on Etsy. A lot of times these are for sale on her Etsy shop. I think they're $4.50 I wrote on there. Okay. And Aim True. She is a designer out of Hartford, South Dakota. And, you know, that's close to my hometown. So I'm going to take a break and put a few more on, and then we'll be done. So really fun sock patterns that have a little kit to them. I knit this pair. They say I farted across the top of them. They're shorty sock. I used Cascade Heritage yarn, and I made them for my daughter because when she was turning 17, she thought gas was really fun, really funny. She still does. So there's the pair I did, little hearts, and then it says, I farted. So I don't have those to show, but I think they're funny. They're by Tabitha Hedrick, and they're from Subversive Socks, and they came out in 2013, and I knit them for Kylie for her birthday. They do make me laugh a little. There's right across the top of your ankle. So if you were out with people and you crossed your leg, it would be kind of funny, kind of cute. These are the My Knitted Heart vanilla socks. I don't think you are gonna be able to see that. This will be much better. And these are the Wicked colorway. And we saw the Broadway show Wicked on Broadway with the original cast, which was just thrilling. To see that, and so I came home and got Wicked color, the green and black for the Wicked Witch, and then did this pattern here, and it's on both sides so that it does provide some of that ease. So you're coming down this way, and then it continues through the back. They're called My Knitted Heart Vanilla Socks. It's a free pattern by Elizabeth Suarez. So those are kind of fun. Wicked themed. Then I have these, and these are the pencil socks. This was a kit that I purchased. I don't know if this kit is still available. I will look and see and put it on the screen. But aren't they fun? You could make these, right? Find some pink, some gray, some yellow. These are great teacher gifts. Just pull this yarn from your, this could even be kind of a gold color. And they are just ribbed here with a little garter stitch there. So those are kind of fun. I like wearing those. And then this is another pair by Wendy Gall. She is the designer who had the podcast, Knitters Brewing Company. And she designed these socks. This was a kit of hers. It's got that same no flap heel gusset. And then you beaded those socks. Those are all little beads. So for those of you that have princess feet, that's not going to be an option for you. Because when you put them on, you tie your shoes, then those little beads can push on the top of your foot. But they sure are cute, aren't they? I think those are really fun. Okay. And then kind of to finish up here, I have a couple more to show on the table. I knit quite a few pairs of socks out of fixation yarn, which is the yarn with elastic in it. And if you have trouble keeping socks up or on, this is a nice option. They come in those little kind of round balls on cardboard that are covered in plastic at the yarn store. And it is definitely a elastic stitch pattern. I did this just in a ribbed pattern, and they really stretch and they feel really good on your feet. So a fixation. I have several pairs of socks in that. I have the Hudson Bay Company socks. These also just a little bit started to bleed, but this is that ribbed pattern that goes down across the top of the foot. So some themed socks as well. I still have quite a few left in this bucket, but I'm not going to go through all of them. I tried to pick the ones that I thought would be kind of most interesting, have something to talk about. I can show these because there are a number of yarn dyers who do these mismatch sets. So you get one red sock and one green sock, or one, you know, orange and blue. At Halloween, you can get, and different dyers call them different names. This has a slip stitch pattern going down. But you get one color of for each sock. So those are kind of fun and kind of quirky. I have knit a couple of pairs of the little shorty socks, ankle socks, and you can use any stitch pattern on those. You can kind of go ahead and, you know, put any stitch pattern you want on a shorty sock pattern. So anyway, I have a couple of other things to talk to you about, but I'm gonna take a quick break and get kind of the table cleared up, and I'll be right back. Before I forget, this is the sock blocker company that I use, Perfectly Catchy Designs. They make wooden sock blockers. I buy them on eBay. I have a horse set for Kylie, a dog set for my husband, and a sheep set as well. His are the sheep. There's a bigger foot on the sheep. So I do have one for each of us. My daughters and I are the same, kind of a medium sock blocker, and then I have the large. And I purchase them online, or you can get them at some of the shows, Stitches. They're usually at Stitches Midwest. But Perfectly Catchy Designs. You can just Google them to get information on having wooden sock blockers. I also have a blue plastic pair that I got from Knit Picks, and they're at the local yarn shop right now with my Up North Cabin socks on display. All right, let's wrap this up today. I will say that I wash and launder my socks by putting them in the washing machine on gentle or delicate. I do have a non-agitating washer, and I lay them out flat to dry. My husband and daughter wear hand knit socks almost every day. So I can know that they're constantly going to be a special load in the laundry that we can do any of our specials or delicates in. But you can run into a problem with that. So these are the Mermaid socks by Lucy Neatby, and I knit them in the Hiawassee Creek Dye Works, who doesn't dye anymore, sock monkey colorway. I cut the toe off in the attempt to see if I could pick up those stitches and knit them longer, because when they got felted, they shrunk. I could still get them on my feet, but I decided it really wasn't worth it. They're laying in a mending bin. They've been there for for years. I'm not certain why this happens, and I'm not an expert, but from information that I have heard, You can overwash your socks and the superwash properties of a sock yarn will go away over time. They use a chemical process to make yarn superwash ready, and that's very hard and very harmful to our environment. And so it, you know, it's controversial in and of itself, but then if you wash them and agitate them and dry them over time, so the properties of that superwash wool can wear away, and then you can get a felted sock. So I think if you are careful in your, you know, washing on cool, so there's not heat and there's not a lot of agitation, putting them in your washing machine is not a problem. But I have had this happen, and this was a superwash yarn. I know that socks that don't have superwash yarn that are knit can often felt if you're not careful with them, but that makes sense, right? That's a wool product. And so I just wanted to mention that not all socks have been successful for me in the long term. Now I'm just going to touch base on a couple of my sock patterns so that you can know. We have talked about these early on in the podcast. These are my Shenana Friends socks. So when you go out and do shenanigans with your friends, they become Shenana Friends. And this is a two-color corrugated ribbing, heel, toe, and cuff. But this stitch pattern is just a simple twisted stitch all the way down. It is the same stitch pattern that I used for my Easiest Cable Hat Ever pattern that came out just a few weeks ago. I really like that stitch pattern. There's a lot of bang for your buck on those. These are really pretty, that speckled colorway. But this pattern is available for individual download on Ravelry as well as in my Etsy shop and on Love Crafts. Here is how you spell Shenana Friends. Wait, it doesn't seem to be focusing this week. There is the sock picture that we took of the girls in the socks sitting with their beautiful dresses on. Here is the other version in the gray with the maroon. This toe is really fun to do. So if you don't want to do the color work here, and here, you might want to just try the toe and leave this as just plain and just get a really nice stitch pattern going on that one. And then the other pair of socks I designed are called the Mr. Tom's Field Socks. When I was growing up in Sioux Falls, Mr. Tom's Field was across the street, and we would play kickball and hide and seek in the tall grass, and there was a big hedge along the back part of that lot, and we played there, and my brothers would catch snakes and gophers, and Mr. Tom's house was there, and we always thought that that was real spooky. It was an older Victorian home, and we'd peek through the hedge and then go running because, you know, we thought Mr. Tom was going to be this scary creature. So I designed this Mr. Tom's Field Sock, and it has a diamond motif of pearl stitches just on the top of the sock. So there you go. Don't know if you're gonna be able to see it. I'll try to take a close-up picture. I have gifted both of the pairs. I went to find a sample and I was like, gosh darn, I think I gave Kylie a pair and her roommate Macy a pair, and I don't have a sample pair of my Mr. Tom's Field socks left. And this is my pattern that has that I put the most time and energy into doing three sizes with that pattern on the top, and it has not been knit by only like one person. So if you want to do a favor to your favorite podcaster, go out and knit those Mr. Tom's Field socks, will you, for me? Because they're really cute, and I don't have a sample, but I also don't have anybody that has knit them. So, all of my patterns on Ravelry are buy three, get one free. So you can put four patterns in your cart and get the last one free if you're looking for kind of a feature on that. Let's do the hellos this week. We have a big list of hellos because so many of you liked my story about my dad growing up in the pharmacy, and I have another little story to tell you about him today. So hello to Denise Norber and Janet Robertson and Amy Mickelson and Pat Wagner and Robin Gasser, all who almost comment weekly, and that is so nice of you. And Marty Mullen, who remembers getting comic books at the pharmacy, which I remember, the Archie comic books. I used to work there, and I would sneak comic books up behind the cash register that I would read while I was waiting for people to check out, and then I'd put them back on the shelf. I'm sure my dad knew that we read all the magazines and comic books in the store, so we were always working. And hi to Jane Engstrom, who just found me recently. And you're welcome to the group, Jane. I'm glad you found me, too. And Kara Parkman and Fernie, who remembers going up to the pharmacy to get Coca-Cola syrup for an upset tummy. And I remember that, too. And Debbie Whitehead and Karina and Bonnie Glass, who had her first job in a pharmacy. And Teresa Olson and Judy Muscroft and the Three Ply Podcast ladies. Hi, ladies. I just watched your last podcast this weekend. You always make me laugh. Melinda and Angela and PJ. Hi, PJ and Liza and Margarita and Beverly and Kat and Olivia, who remembered Wall Drug from South Dakota. She thought it was Hilltop Drug. And I said, no, I think what you're thinking of is Wall Drug, because there are bumper stickers and signs all over the world for Wall Drug and how many hours it is to get, or miles it is to get to Wall Drug. And that is on the other side of the state for me, on your way to Rapid City, all the way across I-90, which is the loneliest stretch of highway in the world between Sioux Falls and Rapid City. And it's just flat and open prairie. Hi, Melissa and Jesse's mom and Gail S., who still has a pharmacy in her small town. Oh, that's so cool. And Pat and Rachel and Danielle, hello. And Glenda and Sue, whose dad was a bottler, and so she worked in his company or would work with him. And Carol and Anna and Brandy and Patricia, hi to all of you. And Julie, who has a Sioux Falls connection, and Joanne and P. Chambers and Sandra and Melanie, who wrote me about a bunch of memories, and Melanie is a friend in real life. Hi, Mel. And Kelly and Peggy and Michelle of Knit Takes Two and Judy B., who is casting on my hat right now. So thank you so much for that, Judy. And Amy B., who talked about Stitches West and just coming home from Stitches West and watching me. And Eleanor, who wanted to know if you could make the shawl from last time without a hood. And I said, yes, absolutely. And I think some people have done that. So you could go take a look at Joe's Pride hooded shawl and make it without the hood. And Michelle and Stephanie, who wants me to look into stem cell stuff, which I have done, but I have some questions about it and I don't know who to ask. I found a place in Minneapolis, and then I found a guy in Minneapolis who got in trouble for doing stem cell stuff. So I am interested, but I don't have all my questions answered. And then Chris Nugent, who says Naperville, Illinois still has a drugstore. And Emma Butcher and Debbie McKenzie. And 619253, who remembers getting ice cream at the fountain. And not getting Coca-Colas, but getting ice cream, having an ice cream. And I think that was also very common in dime stores as well as independent local drugstores. Hi to Kathy B. and Wisconsin Tatter and Eileen and Barbara. And hi to So Run Knit Suzanne, who has an ongoing weekly conversation with me and writes me lovely kind of letters via the computer. And Mary Brevig, who commented out in the Ravelry group to communicate with me. And Rhonda, who is paper savvy. I just want to say thank you to all of you and for commenting. I am still commenting on every comment that I receive. I just am having the best time communicating with people via the internet that way. And I want to remind everyone that I do have a Cori helpline. So if you are stuck and you can't get to your local yarn store because they're closing, you can also contact me and I will help you get through your knitting challenges. Just email me and we'll set up a time to do a Skype or a Google Hangout or a FaceTime, whatever works for you. We can even just do a phone call if that works, you know, better for you. And we will get everybody, you know, up to snuff on what they need to do. Oh, on the bottom of this, I just found, maybe I can splice this back into previous. Here is the Watermelon Slice Socks by Knitters Brewing Company. I missed that in my stack. I'll put that over here. Okay, I did the drawing for the bags. I thought, you know what? You guys watched it in the first 2 weeks. You should have first dibs on winning the awesome Bags by Awesome Granny bags. So I have the two winners. The first winner that I drew for the embroidered, and I still love this bag. I probably need to go buy one, right? Under the pretense that we need to help local people who are losing money because they can't go to shows. Okay, that is going to Ash's Pirate Mom in Kyoto, Iowa, whose favorite swear word is fudge buckets. And I used to say fudge bucket all the time. I want to know where that comes from. Did we hear that as children? Was that a swear word that we used to use? Oh, fudge bucket? I thought that was really cute. Okay, so that one's going out to her. And if you will send me your address, first and last name, and I will get that in the mail to you. And the second bag is going out to Chris O. 1972. And that is Chris from Morristown, Tennessee. And Chris, if you would prefer to have one of Matt's plaid bags from his website, will you let me know, because I can get my hands on one of those and get it for you and ship it out to you. And if you would prefer to have one of Matt's bags as opposed to the one that is a little more floral, but you might be fine with this. You know, kind of a denim color. But if you would prefer, you just let me know and I will go out and get buy one of Matt's bags for you and send it off, because I would love to do that. Okay? To end today, I have a little story. Some of you may have heard this. It's the parable of the cookies and kindness, and the author is unknown. A young lady was waiting the airport's departure area pending her flight home. After realizing there was a delay, she bought a small bag of chocolate chip cookies to enjoy while she waited. She made her way to the VIP lounge to sit and relax. She sat down in an armchair to enjoy her cookies and read a book. Beside her sat a pleasant young man reading his book, the bag of cookies between them. Neither spoke. The young lady took her first cookie, then much to her surprise, the young man also took a cookie. He said nothing, she said nothing, but was clearly bothered. For each cookie she took, he did the same. Again, no words or looks were exchanged, but her anger grew. This continued until there was only one cookie left. Then the man took the last cookie and divided it in half, leaving her half in the bag. Well, that was it. She was so infuriated and bothered by his lack of consideration that she packed up her things and moved. Soon she boarded her flight, took her seat, and began to settle in for her trip, still very upset by this young man's lack of manners. She went into her purse and she felt her heart sink. There in her purse was her bag of cookies, unopened and untouched. She was so ashamed of how she responded and was further upset by the realization that it was too late to make amends and apologize. This young man had shared his cookies without saying a word. He even gave her half of his last one. He wasn't upset or worried about her actions. He gave without condition or feelings or anger or bitterness. There are three things to take away and realize that we can't take back from this modern day parable. The stone after it's been thrown. The word after it's been said. The time after it's gone. I just have heard that a number of times over the years, and I went out in search of it to share with all of you today. Times are challenging right now. We are all in a world of uncertainty, and I just want to reach out and say that I'm a prayerful person, and I will say a prayer for each one of you through this, and I will lift you up in my heart and think of you fondly every day, especially those of you who comment and subscribe. I just have loved building this community with all of you, and I hope that the sock episode, which is not my forte, don't have a ton of knowledge about socks, even though I've knit a ton of them, was something that was a little bit of a nice change of pace for all of you. If things change too much in the future, I might try to do FaceTime live through Facebook or through YouTube. I'll see about looking into something like that. If some of you would be interested in having me chat or have a virtual knit night together, I think that would be a really fun moving forward. So if you don't have anything to comment on this week and would really like to make a comment, but you just don't know what to say, then why don't you tell me about your very first knitting project? come over to the comments or go to Ravelry and into the group and leave me a comment about what your very first knitting project was. And then next week, I will try to bring mine up from the basement and show all of you what my very first knitting project was. So until next time, let's keep it colorful, waddle on, and hold each other in our hearts. I forgot to mention what I'm wearing this week. This is my Irish coffee. You've all seen it before. Great pattern. Everyone should knit one.